Welcome to Christ Virtual Church. Hi, I'm Jeff Exotic, and I'll be your host. No, I'm not the Tiger King. I'm Jeff King. Hey, COVID-19, what up with this, right? COVID-19, how many of you have already discovered that the 19 in COVID-19 stands for the number of pounds you're going to gain staying home? I mean, like 18 hours a day in front of Netflix, right? On the other hand, there are some really, really good things about this, right? For example, I'm getting really, really good mileage on my car these days. Last time I calculated, I was getting something like 3 weeks per gallon. I mean, awesome, right? Well, hey, I'm so excited that you're here right now, that you're joining us, and even if you're not a member of this church, we're so honored that you're being a part of things right now, because all of you, every single one of you, you matter to God and you matter to us. Hey, if you're out there right now, if you're watching on Facebook with us, why don't you let me know that you're out there? Send me a like. Go ahead, be generous. Send me a like. Send me a heart. Send me a comment, because I'm going to be interacting with you all Sunday morning, live, in real time, on Facebook. Okay, well, first of all, our first song today is going to be a great song just designed to put a smile on your face. Here's our band, The Bridge, with Walking on Sunshine.
I'm sure.
This is a totally crazy time of stress and uncertainty, so I'm doing my very best during this time. Just to remind you to stay positive. Here we go.
When your bank account is close to red, you want to cry yourself to bed. It could be worse, you could be dead. Remember what I said, stay positive. When the folks next door have a bigger home, a nice sports car and a garden gnome, wow. Your minivan has zero chrome, you're blessed with what's your own, stay positive.
Happy Sunday! Well, I don't know about you, but I just love that little opening song. I can't get it out of my head. But then again, who would want to get a song like that out of their head? Am I right? Am I right? I mean, it's just so... Well, hey, listen, folks. Listen, folks, I'm getting sick of all the negativity out there these days, aren't you? I mean, people have turned complaining into some kind of an art form. Like, for example, people love to complain about the weather. It's too cold out there. It's too hot out there. I wonder if people in Southern California complain, it's too perfect out there. Like, Mabel, it's perfect again. It's a gorgeous day. I'm sick of it, right? And how many of you like to complain about other drivers out there on the road? Let me ask you this. How many of you would say that you are an above average driver? Now, think about this, because I asked this question once to a large audience of people, and I said, raise your hand if you think honestly you are an above average driver. And like every hand in the place went up. And therein lies the problem. If the majority of us think we're above average, then the majority of us think that we have a right to criticize everybody else. Like, hey, buddy, what are you, blind or something? You can just hear it. We complain about all sorts of things. There are people who drive their car up to the house. They press a button and doors open up for them. They drive into a climate-controlled environment and press the button again. And the doors shut themselves. Then they get out of their car and they walk into another climate-controlled environment. And what do? They walk up to their refrigerator, which is filled to overflowing with food, and they complain, there's nothing good to eat here. They walk over to the TV and turn it on with 937 different stations. And what do they say? They complain, there's nothing good to watch tonight. Then they go to their closet, filled with rows of clothing, and they run their hand down those clothes, and they say, yep, you guessed it. Say it out loud if you know what I'm going to say. I've got nothing to wear, right? It's amazing to me. It's amazing how blessed we can be, and yet how ungrateful we are. I want to show you an amazing story about Jesus. The Bible talks about a time when Jesus went on a road trip. Road trip, right? Here's what happened. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, Jesus, Master, have pity on us. Now, as we read this right now, it's easy to kind of go, all right, got it, move on and keep reading. But you've got to understand that they were crying out from the depths of their heart, from the depths of their soul, crying out more than we can ever comprehend, because leprosy was a death sentence. I mean, just a flat out death sentence. You would die this slow death by literally having your skin rot away. I mean, one day your nose falls off. One night, you're asleep and rats chew your toes off and you didn't even wake up. I know it's disgusting, but that's the way it was. It was kind of like a real-life episode of The Walking Dead. You know, T-W-D, right? Because it was so disgusting, you were not allowed to have any contact with other human beings. And I think some of you know what that feels like just about now. Stay home, quarantine, social distancing. In fact, get this. You were required by law back then. If you had leprosy, you were required by law to dress in rags and to wear your hair all crazy and long and uncombed like you're in a 90s grunge band. And if anybody came anywhere close to you, you were supposed to shout out from a distance, unclean, unclean. Kind of like when I'm working out and I'm all sweaty and gross. If Kathy walks into the same room, I have to shout from a distance, unclean, unclean, so she doesn't accidentally walk over and hug me. So these guys are trapped. Trapped in a life of, total disgust and despair. Decay, decomposition, death. And they cry out through their cracked and rotting lips. They cry out, Jesus, Master, have pity on us. And Jesus, he sees their oozing cheeks and their discolored eyes. And what does he do? The Bible says, when he saw them, he said, go, show yourselves to the priests. And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back and praising God in a loud voice, he threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give praise to God except this foreigner? So, how many were healed? Would you say it out loud right now, nice and loud, because the people with you're watching with right now may not be as smart as you. So how many were healed? Say, 10, right? I know you said that so loud at home that you woke up, the old man sleeping upstairs, he just popped out of bed and said, what is it? What happened? What happened? He's in a panic right now. So again, how many were healed? 10. How many came back to say thank you? 1. 1. Hey, am I a good teacher or are you just a good congregation? You guys are great. Okay, 1. Well, here's the thing. With everything in me, I want to be that one. I want to be that one son of a gun. That one grateful son of a gun who turns around and goes looking for Jesus. Who goes back just to say thank you for everything. Don't you want to be that one? Don't you? So how do we get that way? Well, here's a thought. Today I want to teach you 3 statements. 3 statements that will help you choose gratitude each day. Here we go. The first one is, I want you to say, I know every good thing I have comes from God. 1, I know every good thing I have comes from God. Here's what it says in the Bible. Every good and perfect gift comes from where? Above. Above. Oh, you got that, huh? You're such a good congregation today. Well, Christmas Day. Christmas Day 1944, the soldier climbed out of his foxhole. The temperature was below 0. The snow creaked beneath his feet. Each breath sent a cloud of frost into the frigid morning air. The forest around him seemed just so quiet, unnaturally quiet. Suddenly there was a high screech of incoming artillery. Instantly, the air around him was exploding. Trees shattering, men screaming, bullets slicing the air. It was the bloody World War II Battle of the Bulge, and he was in the dead center of it. He dove for the ground, and as the artillery shells exploded everywhere around him, he thought, this is it. This is it. The last Christmas I'll ever have. I'll never make it home. Well, he was wrong about that. Boy, was he wrong. He made it home, became a founding member of this church, raised a beautiful family, and shared 71 more Christmases with them. And on Christmas Day, 71 years later, he died at the age of 93. Back in 1944, the old fighter said, "This is it. The last Christmas I'll ever have. I'll never make it home." On Christmas Day, 71 years later, he finally made it home. He looked around heaven and he said, "I'm home. I'm home. Home for Christmas." You know, he once said this to me, "Jeff, I cheated death back then. I don't know why I lived and all the guys around me died. The way I see it, now every day is a bonus." Do you see that too? Do you see that every day you have is a bonus? That every day the good Lord gives you is a gift? And every good thing I have, every good thing you have, it all comes from above. God gives you life to bless you, health to strengthen you, friends to support you, family to love you, church to encourage you. Every good thing you have comes from God. And we need to understand that God is completely good. He is constantly good. He is unchangingly good. God cannot be less than good. He will never not be good to you. Everything our God does is good, and once we embrace that, it changes. It naturally changes our attitude. Instead of an attitude of entitlement, we embrace an attitude of gratitude. And the way I see it, every day is a bonus, and every good gift is from above. And then another thing, second statement, I will not let what I want rob me of what I have. I will not let what I want rob me of what I have. I don't know what you want. A lot of people want a better car. I want a way better car. I want a bigger house, and I want somebody else to clean it. I want granite countertops in that house because food doesn't taste as good off that old laminate stuff. I don't know what you want, but don't let it rob you of what you have. You know, wise old King Solomon said in the Bible, "Better what the eye sees than the roving of the appetite." Better, in other words, what you have right in front of your very own two eyes, right in front of you at the moment, than always wanting something more, something different. And whenever we adopt an attitude of gratitude for what we've got right in front of us, gratitude turns whatever we have into enough. I mean, that's so good, I'm going to say it again because somebody's going to get it. Gratitude turns whatever we have into enough. And what's crazy to think about is it's not happy people who are grateful. It's grateful people who are happy. Let that soak in. It's not happy people who are grateful. It's grateful people who are happy. And what do you have right now, right in front of your own two eyes? Just the average person listening to me right now, what do you have? Well, first of all, you probably have three meals a day. Some of you have four or five meals a day, and we should talk about that. You should probably limit that. And when you're done with this whole stay-at-home business, almost all of us could afford to go out to a restaurant if we wanted to. And we could just sit there, and other people would serve us. Almost all of us have a bed to sleep in, a roof over our heads, clothes to wear. You've got shoes. I mean, you have work shoes, running shoes, hiking shoes. You've got brown shoes, black shoes, white shoes. You've got heels, pumps, flats. Some of you have a pair of shoes just dedicated for when you mow your lawn. Those of you who have a job, you're incredibly blessed. You say, no, not me, Jeff. I just work for minimum wage. Listen, if you make minimum wage, you make 51 times the average wage of the average person living in this world today. Most of you have a phone that does things, incredible things that you couldn't even imagine 10 years ago. You can sit there in your living room and you can push a button on your phone and a signal invisibly goes up into the heavens and then comes back down, and maybe 20 minutes later you have a pizza delivered to your front door. You may have a little helper in your house right now, living in your home with you, a little helper who never complains or argues with you. Alexa, buy toilet paper. Alexa, play this song. Most of you are so blessed. You actually upgrade things that work. I mean, you take your working thing in and you upgrade it for another working thing. I mean, I don't know about you, but I'm going to choose gratitude. Every good thing is a gift from God, and I will not let what I want rob me of what I have. And another thing, and this is equally powerful, I'll turn every blessing I have into praise. Statement number three, I'll turn every blessing I have into praise. Why? Because if I don't turn it into praise, it turns into pride. Pride says, sure, I got a lot of stuff, but I earned that. I'm entitled to that. In fact, I should have more stuff. Instead, I like what King David said. I want to have an attitude like David. David said, I will praise you as long as I live. I will be fully satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you. You're doing that today, aren't you? I mean, just sitting there in your pajamas, rocking out with Christ Virtual Church. You're doing that because your heart is full. Your heart is grateful. And you're just praising your God. You're doing that today, and let me tell you how you can do that every day. How do you live grateful every day? Let me teach you an exercise. I'll do this. I'll tell you a story first, and then I'll teach you an exercise. So, here's the story. True story. Years ago, I was running errands on a beautiful summer Saturday afternoon, and I decided to pop into the package store to buy a package. It might have been a six package, in fact. Anyway, my little son, Zach, was in the car with me. He was strapped in his car seat, and I thought, you know, I'm going to be in and out of there probably in less than a minute. So I'm just going to zip into the store, and I'll come back out, and it'll all be over real quick, so I'm not going to bother taking him out of his car seat and going through all that hassle. Well, once I got into the store, I kept running into people that I knew from church. Because let's face it, with our church, you see more people in a packy on a Saturday than a church on a Sunday with our members, okay? So I was only gone, I was gone for 4 or 5 minutes. But here's where it gets serious. When I got back to that car, my little boy Zach was just crying his eyes out. And his face was beet red. And I opened the door and I felt this wave of heat. It had to be, I don't know, 90, 100 degrees in that car. It was my worst parenting mistake, I think, ever. I almost became one of those stories that you see on TV with the parent who leaves their child in an overheated car. He doesn't even remember the day, but I'll never forget it because it was traumatic for me. And all I could think at that moment, all I could think on that Saturday afternoon is, what if? What if I had been in that store maybe 1 minute longer? What if I became another one of those stories and I lost my child? And at that moment, I could have been having the worst day of my entire life. The worst day ever. But instead, it was all turned around, and all I could say was, God, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, God. Thank you. What changed? It was the same day. I mean, it was the same kid in the back seat of the car. What had changed? My perspective. All I had is what I had when I started that day. Nothing had changed but my perspective. Okay, here's the exercise now. I want all of you to do this, okay? Think of something you have and pretend you just lost it. Let me help you. Your job. You just heard you're losing your job. You are now unemployed, no paycheck. Your health. Bad news. You have stage 4 cancer. Your house. You get a call today from the police department. There's been some kind of an electrical fire, and your house is a total loss. The police say to you, do you have some place that you can go, or shall we contact the Red Cross? So take something that you take for granted now. Pretend you lost it. Pretend you lost it. Now pretend you just got it back. Oh, I didn't lose my job. I mean, I don't know if I like that job that much, but I love getting a paycheck. Or how about this? You mean I don't have cancer? I'm healthy? You mean this week isn't going to be filled with chemo treatments? And my house, that was all a mistake? I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful. See, what I'm saying is don't miss the power of this. Take something that you just always take for granted every single day and pretend that you lost it. Then pretend that you got it back, and suddenly, now your heart is grateful. Now you're so grateful for what you already have. For example, God, thank you for my health. Thank you for my house. Thank you for my job. You know, my house is small, but God, I'm grateful. I've got a roof over my head and a place to keep me warm in the winter. And God, my house is a mess right now, but I'm grateful. I've got these little kids running around the house making a mess of it. And maybe I don't like my stupid job, but God, I'm grateful I've got a job. And God, thank you that I'm not waking up this morning facing chemo, facing radiation, facing morphine. Nobody says it better than David. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget all the good things he does for me. He forgives all my sins and heals all my diseases. He redeems me from death and crowns me with love and tender mercies. He fills my life with good things. Wow. He fills my life with good things. I can't argue with that. No, sir, I can't argue with that. He is that good. So let's now, with grateful hearts, let's go to him, bowing before him in prayer. And Father, I'm going to be honest with you. It's just so easy to slip into negativity. We just seem to drift that direction. So I'm asking you today for help to stay positive. I want to be grateful, grateful for everything that you've given me. I know every good gift I have comes from you. I want to be the 1 in 10 who turns around to say thanks. And Lord, I don't want to let what I want rob me of what I have. I already have so much, and I'm so grateful. So from now on, I'm turning every blessing I have into praise. Like David, let all that I am praise the Lord, because he fills my life with good things. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And I invite you now to continue your prayers with us as we pray together in unison those words which Jesus taught us so long ago. We pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now I want you to have a heart that is just so filled with gratitude. Just, I mean, like filled to overflowing. Because you know what? If you and I started to make a list of all of our blessings right now, we could just get up to 10,000 and we would have only begun to scratch the surface. This is our band, The Bridge, with 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship His holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, for the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Hey, join us again next week as we continue our series, Stay Positive. This is a tough time, I admit that, but I'm going to do my best next week to encourage you. And more than that, I'm going to show you how you can be a person who encourages the people around you. the people sheltering with you, the people who are close to you right now. Well, here's a preview.
When your friend is looking fat, 'cause he sits at home all day with his cat, you could try giving him a yoga mat, but he might not like that, but stay positive. When the girl at work is feeling sad, she's way behind and the boss is mad, give her a hand that she has not had, and let her know it's not so bad, but stay positive.
Our final act of worship today is when we bring our gift to our God. Go to our website, clcsouthwick.org, and click on the Giving tab on the homepage. And again, thanks everybody. I love you. And now, may the risen Christ be with you this week. May he walk ahead of you to lead you and guide you. May he walk behind you to support you and encourage you. And may he walk beside you as your best and closest friend. Amen. And go now with joy. We will, for we go with God.